Hi, I'm Dave Williams, the CTO of Massdriver, and today I'm going to give you a quick tour of the platform. So what we can see here is some Terraform. We've written it a million times. We know it. We love it. This is like the scope of a module. We're just creating a DynamoDB table. I've also included some IAM roles with read-write-split because I, as ops, know that policy of least privilege is really important, but maybe your developers are less familiar, so I provide these for them. You can also see that we have this monitoring file where I add some basic alarms. I like to do this, but it's not strictly necessary for the platform, but it's great for reusability. For the purposes of this demo, we're going to be looking at Terraform, but it doesn't necessarily need to be. It could be Helm, it could be CloudFormation, it could be Pulumi. Massdriver's goal is to optimize your operations teams, and if we make the decision about your IAC tooling, we're not doing that. So where Massdriver actually comes in is just one step above this. This is the Massdriver bundle specification. It wraps your IAC modules and provides a couple of unique features. So the first is a metadata API that allows you to catalog your modules and make it discoverable in the Massdriver catalog. Next is the param schema. The param schema is a method to define user inputs for your modules. The only thing to know for now is it's simple JSON schema, but Massdriver adds some state-aware magic, which allows you to create validations based on the current state of the module. So if it's already been deployed to the cloud, or if it's being deployed for the first time. The last thing the bundle specification does is define inputs and outputs we call connections and artifacts. Connections are dependencies to deploy a module. You can see here, to make a DynamoDB table, I need some type of Massdriver IAM role. This is the only requirement needed to deploy this to the cloud. Next, we have artifacts. When we create a DynamoDB table, it will create a type of AWS DynamoDB table. This is just structured JSON that defines what a DynamoDB table is to us. So that includes a resource ID, those policies that we created, if it were RDS, maybe a security group, so a downstream could connect back securely without turning your VPC to Swiss cheese or your IAM into something unmanageable. Now let's publish this bundle into the Massdriver Package Manager and see what the experience is going to be like for your developers. Here is the Massdriver canvas. When it comes time for a developer to use that DynamoDB module, they'll type DynamoDB into the catalog, grab a Dynamo and drag it on. They can give it a useful name like User Sessions. For this demo, we're going to look at a module that has already been deployed. As you can see here, when we click into this configuration tab, we see the result of our parameter schema. You will notice that the region is grayed out. This is for a reason. If you try to change the region of a module that's already been deployed, it will cause a delete and recreate, and that would lead to data loss. This is an example of an operational constraint. There are things in the cloud that are inherently dangerous. Being proactive instead of reactive enables operations teams to prevent costly mistakes long before they happen. Another example of an operational constraint is here in our RDS module. Notice that all lower versions are disabled. In AWS, reducing your version results in a delete and recreate. However, increasing the version is either a small downtime or no downtime at all. Enforcing this constraint is only possible with the Massdriver state-aware validation system. There is another type of constraint that exists that's more implicit. These are our organizational constraints. Your CTO, your CFO, your CISO, they all have opinions about how you run your software and your infrastructure in the cloud. However, they can't be represented in every single PR. It's important to, again, become proactive to enforce these organizational constraints. So as you can see here in my DynamoDB table, our billing mode is set to provisioned with a read capacity of 5 and a write capacity of 4. Now let's say a developer wants 5,000 read capacity. This puts us in a pretty dangerous situation when it comes to a PR review. Due to the declarative nature of IAC, you would have to know that AWS's maximum is 3,000. This would cause a broken commit on main and block your pipeline. We want to be proactive in making sure things like that don't happen. You can see here that not only are we not capping at 3,000, we're actually capping at 400 read capacity. Now maybe this is because due to our own organizational constraints, we think that it is better to run your DynamoDB table in pay-per-request mode. Notice when we change the billing mode, we actually got rid of read and write capacity. This is because these are fields that are not required when we're in pay-per-request mode. Now let's say our developer figured it out and decided they only needed 6 read capacity. They would fill that in, come down and hit deploy. This will send a message to our air-gapped provisioning system, which will actually deploy this module to the cloud, creating a DynamoDB table. Let's wait for the provisioning run to start. There we go, MassDriver's provisioning system has picked it up and started to roll it out. In moving from a traditional GitOps model to something like a UI that is fully self-serviceable, there are a few things that we really don't want to lose. One of those things is rich history and the ability to understand how a system came to be in the state that it currently is. If we go over into our history tab here, what you can see is a snapshot of every time our DynamoDB table was deployed with all of its configuration. We can even compare two points in time to see what's changed from one deployment to another. As you can see here, I actually changed the read capacity from 6 to 5 in my previous deployment. Now the last piece of the MassDriver bundle specification that I talked about was inputs and outputs. So we can see here our DynamoDB table will actually output a type of AWS DynamoDB. And remember, it's just structured JSON. So now we have the ability to pass that information forward to our chat application, which takes a type of AWS DynamoDB. Because of our type system, MassDriver actually prevents misconfiguration by connecting two modules that are incompatible. When the chat application finally receives the appropriate artifact, information like security groups, ARNs, and policies get passed forward, no copy-paste required. The magic of MassDriver is that the chat application is native Helm, while AWS DynamoDB table is Terraform. Because each speak JSON natively now with the MassDriver bundle spec, you get true interoperability between your IAC tooling, while your developers get the same consistent experience whether it's Pulumi, whether it's Helm, or whether it's Terraform. Providing that consistent user experience without sacrificing the right tool for the job is how you reclaim your engineering velocity and cut the red tape from DevOps.